Watch the butcher shine his knife. And this town is full of battered wives. Round and round.
Hello and welcome to the Dollhouse. My name is Kit Kowalski. I'm an Australian feminist researcher and blogger. I'm joined by my co-host, Edie Wyatt, who writes for The Spectator and whom you can also find on Substack. We're here to talk about sex, gender, and all the nonsense in the Antipodes. And today we are joined by two very special guests. We have Sue Clarke and Leah Whiston, who are women's rights campaigners with the group Woman Up in Queensland. Thank you so much for joining us, guys.
Hello.
Hi. Thanks for having us.
Hi, ladies. I'm in Brisbane too, so we're all in the same city. And we've met a few times over the years at different events. Lee and Sue have been very active in a number of other groups, so they're hard workers. And they've been in this a few years. I interviewed Sue a couple of years ago when, Sue, you were unceremoniously chucked out of the... Justice Party, is that right?
I actually resigned because, because I had actually liked an article on Facebook. Julie, is it, how do you pronounce it? Zego? That one. And because I'd liked something on Facebook, I got taken in by the committee and spoken to for about 3.5 hours with another candidate. And I resigned. Because they basically wanted us to go through gender training, in other words, indoctrinate us. And so 3 weeks out from the federal election, I resigned.
Yeah, and it was really captured too. The guy who runs, one of the higher up guys, isn't it, is really...
He was an MP in Victoria. So the Animal Justice Party had something like 3 MPs, state MPs across Australia. So he did yield some power because of that, yeah.
Yeah, it's not uncommon we hear like these organisations get corrupted, don't they?
Yeah, and he has 2 children, both trans-identifying. So he's basically using the Animal Justice Party as a platform to promote this ideology.
Tremendous coincidence, isn't it, that 2 of his children would have something that's very, you know.
Rare, yeah, both of them, 2 children, trans-identifying.
And Lee's been out on the streets for a while. I don't want to put an ungenerous spin on that. She runs by on the streets. She runs Speaker's Corners regularly. I've been to a few of them around Brisbane.
Yeah, every month we do them. Before that, I think I've probably been doing it for about a year now. Before that, we were going to, and this is where I met Sue and yourself, Evie, at IWD Brisbane Meandering Events.
Yeah.
And that's when I started really getting involved with it. And that's when I first spoke as well. And I wouldn't say I enjoyed it, but I enjoyed the effect that it had on me. And I think doing the speaker's corners, you can see when other women get up to speak who have never spoken before, it's amazing. And it's happening more and more women.
We actually had one woman yesterday that just came to us, and she felt so emboldened. She got up there and said something.
That was lovely, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was really good.
Something about getting in there and speaking the truth out as well. You know, when I started to speak, a lot of them are held up near George Street, which is where these decisions are made that we're finding so damaging. And it's something about standing up and saying, look, I dissent from this.
Yeah,
we had, we did a few events in Sydney last year. And it's kind of funny because Sydney has its own speaker's corner already, and there are guys who go there every weekend to go and speak. So we had to kind of mix in with them a little bit, and they're not really used to dealing with a lot of women, I think most of them. But, Yeah, it was actually fantastic. You know, you sort of had this feeling like, oh, I'm going to get up and say something and, you know, people will have a bad reaction to it. But we found that even these guys there who were quite sexist in a lot of their dealings with us and, you know, quite off-putting, even they really listened and were really interested in what we had to say. And we had a lot of passers-by who would stop and listen and want to know more and want to know more about what we were talking about and why we had come out. And we just got a phenomenal amount of support from the public. It's really great to actually get out and, as you say, speak the truth.
And you do get a lot of support from the public as well.
Yeah.
Way more support than you do negative. Because yeah. We are speaking truth.
Yeah. And we've been getting it. Yeah, we've been getting out there for quite some time, and it's amazing. I would say it's well above 90% of the public that don't support gender ideology.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, we even did marches through the street last year, and it's quite amazing the support we were getting, people clapping, coming out for support. So it's just that people are afraid to come forward or say anything.
Or they don't know what's going on. Yeah. So many people just don't know.
And then when they find out, they're horrified.
Mm.
So, and that's why there's no debate.
No, well, they won't allow it, will they?
Yeah.
Lee, you seem to have a particular sort of heart for young girls, women and young girls, like many mothers have. And you've taken an interest in the activities of a plastic surgeon we have here in Brisbane, in the Valley, and you found out some interesting things, because one of the narratives we get told is that this is not happening. If you go on Twitter and you see the progressive narrative and you say, look, you know, there, particularly when Catherine Deaves came out and said something about mutilating children, they came out and said in their droves, this is not happening. There is no surgeries happening on minors in this country, who were essentially, from our perspective, these surgeries are medicalizing gender variants, which many of us object to because we were, as young people, gender variant. But you found out that it turns out that it is happening.
Yeah. Well, first of all, I'd actually encourage everybody to be involved in looking at Reddit, because there's a lot that goes on Reddit. And I do talk to people about that, and they don't seem to know what Reddit is. And I think it's the most active place on the internet where these kids are hanging out. And you can really get a feel for what the psychology of these children. They're very lonely, they're very isolated, they're looking for advice, they're looking for affirmation. It's actually heartbreaking. But anyway, so I'm scrolling through Reddit, and there's a group called Transgender AU, and it's for kids who think that they're transgender in Australia, obviously. And I came across a post from a young girl, 15-year-old girl, who obviously calls herself a boy, trans boy. But I came across this really long post that she'd written, and it was basically detailing the whole process that she went from A to Z of how she got her double mastectomy. And she saved up for 2 years out of her pocket money. So she was 13 when this was started, which is the prime age, isn't it, for these kids to get sucked into this. It's the prime age for you to get sucked into any kind of fad, I suppose. So she was 13 when she started saving up. Her parents were divorced and they went half each on the remainder of the price for the surgery. And she just detailed everything that she went through, the consultations that she had with her psychologists and psychiatrists, which were 20-minute long, two of. And she thought this was a great thing because, you know, anything else would be gatekeeping. So she had the two consultations. She had a letter which from her psychiatrist at the Children's Hospital in Brisbane.
We know who that psychiatrist is. I won't name them, but we know who it is. And we talked about that Children's Hospital a few weeks ago too.
Right, yeah. Yeah. So basically that's all she had to do. And she says that she even costed every single thing that she had to pay for, from anesthetics to binders to everything. The actual surgery, I think it all came to about 15 grand. I can't remember now, but the post is on there. And she named the surgery. So go on.
Oh, I was just going to say, I have done a little bit of reading through, Transgender AU on Reddit. Mm. And actually one point I went through and I looked at, because they always come and they do reviews. They all, you know, because they've done this thing now, they've participated, and they go and they actually, you know, do the review of what happened and how much they spent and how was their surgeon. And
meticulous. They're kind of personalities that get involved in this. I mean, that's the personality traits are very much that, very meticulous, very wanting to be detailing every single thing that happened. It's why they're, I think it's why they're kind of outcast as girls. Carry on. Yeah.
Well, it's an autistic trait, isn't it? Yeah.
It is. Yes. It is.
Yeah.
And it's this real sort of consumer mentality, like, you know, I've gone ahead and I've done it and now I'm going to report back to everybody what's happened and how. And it really did surprise me how affordable these mm-hmm. surgeries were. So if you're a 16-year-old, when you want to get a secondhand car, you're looking at between, you know, what, $5,000 to $10,000 for a good secondhand car.
My daughter paid $8,000 for a first car, I think.
That's what you'll pay for a double mastectomy. Mm-hmm. So if you're saving up your, you know, from your shifts at McDonald's or whatever, it's so affordable.
And we did the same thing for the car. We paid half. We said you should save up for half.
Yeah. Well, that's normal. A dollar for dollar. A normal thing to do as parents, isn't it?
Or, you know, you want to go overseas and, you know, if you want to go study abroad, or you want to go have like the European backpacking trip or something like that when you're in your late teens.
Because you want to support them, but you want to encourage them to save.
It's that order of magnitude. And it's so, it really shocked me how affordable it was. I think from the tallying up I did, it was around, the out of pocket was between $8,000 and $15,000, depending on your surgeon and all the other things that happened that you got done. So, it's quite shocking. Anyway, keep going on. So you found out the name of the surgeon?
Yeah, it is shocking. It's heartbreaking. It's shocking. It's just awful. So she said the name of the surgery, and she also gave the name of the surgeon who performed it, who I later found out was a woman. So I posted the Reddit post on Twitter, and I said, this is happening, this is someone's account. And someone, rightly so, said, well, how do you have proof? This is a Reddit post, but, you know, how do you have proof? And I thought, fair play. What I'll do is I'll phone them. And I phoned the surgeon on a whim. I just thought, I need to just phone them and see what's going on here. So I phoned them and I just asked, I said, can you tell me your protocol around top surgery for trans boys so I can pass information on to, I said, my client. And she said, yeah, without hesitation, she said, you need a letter from your psychiatrist at least 3 months in advance and 13 years or up. And I felt sick. My heart just hearing the words from the person who works there just made me feel, I can't really describe how I felt. It was just awful. But I wasn't recording that phone call, and I thought, because I did record one after, I thought I need to phone back and get this information recorded because this is the proof. So I phoned back about an hour later and I spoke to someone else, and she said, and I asked the same question, and she said, yeah, a letter from your psychiatrist for 3 months in advance. And she said 15 years are up. And I said, oh, right, okay. So I thought the lady before said 30, and she went, well, yeah, 15, but technically, but we can do 13. I asked some questions, and silly me, I didn't write down the answers. Can I ask you?
Yes.
Okay. So I was asking about the protocol of top surgeries for trans boys. And I couldn't remember if she said the letter from the psychiatrist had to be 5 months or 3 months in advance.
Minimum of 3 months before surgery.
Right, okay,
so,
then.
If you have a surgery date, that letter has to be dated within 3 months of that appointment.
Okay, that's good, that's great.
Yeah,
and sorry, carry on.
Any sooner than that, it needs to be done again.
Okay, so it would just need to be done again if anything was to crop up and it didn't go again. Okay, cool. And it was it 15 and upwards, the age limit, or have I got that right?
Yeah, that's correct.
15 and upwards. I couldn't remember if she said 15 or 13.
Technically, you can go and go from 13.
Right.
But generally speaking, 15 is.
Okay, cool. All right, that's great. I've written that down, so I shouldn't need to call you again. I'll pass that all on to my client. Thank you.
Bye.
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 And I could hear in her voice that she didn't feel comfortable about it. I was just shocked again. Anyway, I posted the phone call on our Twitter page because I just thought people need to hear this. This is what's going on in Brisbane, in my city. That's how we found out about it. And then, as you know, we turned up at the actual place with some signs.
I'll put the pictures up. I'll cut them into
the
video. But yeah. A couple of you just turned up, and the logistics of it. If your process is less than how many, you don't need a permit.
If it's less than 15,
okay,
you don't need a permit.
Can I just ask a couple of things about the phone call? Did they make it hard for you at all to obtain that information? Did you have to sort of drag it out of them, or?
The phone calls were less than a minute long.
Oh, my God.
It was just what they do, you know. Mm. I mean, I haven't got proof that they've actually done this to a 13-year-old, only that they are willing to.
Yeah.
Whether they have or not, I don't know.
Yeah, they didn't sort of have to go and ask someone or check their records or check their policies.
They knew the information.
Far out.
Yeah.
There was a long pause, though, wasn't there, when she was going to answer you whether or not it was 13? There was quite a...
There was a bit of a pause because I know that she did feel uneasy about saying that 13, but the woman who I spoke to before just said it outright. So, I mean, I can't say for sure, but I would probably imagine that that's not the only place in Queensland who were doing it at that age. And... people just can't get their head around it. I find it hard to get my head around too, but it is happening. You know, laws and guidelines are being broken.
Yeah.
For money, for profit.
Yeah. And this is coming, you know, we looked last week at some, the Denton's document and some other documents we're getting from kind of narrative generation machines and lawyers and people who, consultants. This is where this push is coming from. There's no grassroots, you know, protest around 13-year-old girls, which all of a sudden popped up in the population saying, look, remove our breasts, remove our breasts. This is not a natural occurring phenomenon. This is something that has been generated by almost like a cult-like ideology, which has been injected into these girls' lives, really, isn't it?
And you can see it when you're scrolling through these Reddit posts. You can just see what's happening, how they're being swept up in it, with everyone else doing the same thing. And they want to please their group, who they probably never even met in real life.
Yeah, it's that it's that preferred topic phenomenon, isn't it? It's the, you know, when you're socially awkward, or, you know, as most teenagers are, sort of grappling with those questions of, you know, who am I? Where do I fit in? What's my purpose? How am I going to make myself useful? What career am I going to have? There's a lot of big questions. And, you know, this is something that gives the answers. It gives a lot of answers to young people. It gives you the identity, and it also gives you a project to work on. So, you know, you don't have to think about what am I going to do for the rest of my life. You've got the next 5 to 8 years mapped out for you. First, I'm going to get on blockers. Then I'm going to get on testosterone. Then I'm going to have top surgery. Then I'm going to save up for bottom surgery. And then I'm going to get a Grindr account and find a husband. It's, you know.
These kids have grown up online. They're perpetually online. They've got an online presence. They've probably got an avatar, and they can probably choose which sex they want to be known as online. And, you know, sexual abuse from older men to young girls happens online all the time. We know that. So if they can opt out of that and choose to be a boy online, they might get used to that idea of feeling safe as a boy.
Yeah, 100%.
But the pushing of this also is, you know, because who wants a prepubescent girl? You know, because we know these blockers don't, or boy, we know these blockers don't actually pause puberty. They stop it.
Yeah.
And then the cross-sex hormones means that child doesn't actually go through puberty. Puberty is halted, and all the benefits of puberty as well, including, you know, some cognitive maturity, is stopped. So who would want that, you know, for a person? So there has been implications that that a lot of this is really noncy, to use a word we were using last week. It's sick, because it's injecting the state and lobby groups into the sexuality of prepubescent children and stopping their puberty, and then making them adults who are never able to climb.
And it's a huge moneymaker as well, because these drugs and hormones are lifetime. They're for a lifetime. And these surgeries.
Surgeries
don't stop at one surgery. They have to keep going back for revision after revision, after complication after complication. It's so lucrative.
I read somewhere that each child that goes through this is worth $2 million Australian in their lifetime.
Yeah, I read that too, yeah.
So, you know, it's guaranteed source of income for these people, isn't it?
I don't think the government would be pushing it if it wasn't worth money.
No. And the worst part is it's state sanctioned.
Yeah.
You know, where a government's supposed to protect these young kids, they're actually encouraging.
There's like an ecosystem of markets that have sprung up around transgender identities. And, you know, I think it's really more that there are a lot of people who get a little bit, and like you say, it's recurring revenue over their lifetime. So there's a lot of money in the charity sectors, because it's this new vulnerable group to take care of. You know, the doctors get a bit, the surgeons get a bit, the psychiatrists get a bit. Everybody kind of gets a little slice of that pie, and it's like that. What did they say in there was a Netflix special about Facebook that came out last year, I think, and there was a tagline which was, if you're not paying for the product, then you are the product.
Yeah.
And it's very much like that. You know, this is government subsidized. A lot of this, you're not paying full price for these surgeries. And in the US, I know Exelancic does a lot of work about talking about how the private health insurance covers a lot of it. that person is the product. They're not paying out of pocket for this stuff. Yeah.
And they also provide useful, they're useful to the narrative. The fact that they are vulnerable, or that the vulnerability claims, particularly the mental health claims, form the basis for a new form of censorship, which we're seeing online. So they're silencing dissent pretty much from this entire way of doing politics and way of doing advocacy and way of doing social justice. They silence the dissent, people who don't agree with them, people who don't agree with the policies, because they redefine us as haters. Because, like, you know, I mean, you see authoritarian regimes and they put their military in the children's hospital because they know the enemy's not going to bomb them, because they know the enemy's not going to bomb the children's hospital, right? Because they're too compassionate. So they bet on that. They bet that we're not going to attack them because they put the vulnerable trans kid right out the front. This is the kid that's most vulnerable and you're not allowed to attack them. But behind that kid, they've got all their political strategies and objectives to silence us as well. So it's a multi-headed beast, this thing. And so you got your mates together. You and your mates went down to the valley with your big sign and you just put it up out the front?
Yeah, tell us about what you did next.
Yeah, Sue, you go.
Okay, well, there were five of us, and Leah made this wonderful banner, and it named the clinic and said they perform double mastectomies on minors. So it didn't mention the age, just under minors. And then someone else had and it's another sign, a smaller sign, and it just said, "Leave our kids alone." Mm. And we stood on the corner opposite the Wickham Hotel, which is a major trans hangout in Brisbane.
Well, this is a traditional, just to give you some context, the Valley is a traditional place, a gay place in the city, particularly for gay men. In Brisbane, West End used to be kind of the lesbian centre, and the Valley was always, it was the first, you know, the first gay bar was, even when I was young, there was, you know, it was the gay central.
And they had a outside the hotel all the way around it, trans flag, not the trans flag, but the, you know, the trans pride flag.
Yeah, progress flag.
Yeah, the progress flag. And even the Australia Post boxes had the same flag on them. And I think, Leah, you said there was on the street.
Yeah, there was a zebra crossing and progress flag as well. Yeah, so we were pretty surrounded by the progress.
And right in the middle, they sacrifice the children, right? They've got religion everywhere.
Well, literally, that is the place where they are.
Where we perform rituals on children, where we remove sex.
So we thought, well, this is really, you know, the epicenter of this sort of thing. We weren't sure the sort of response that we would get. But
there was someone in the Wickham pub giving us the finger quite early on.
But we were surprised at how much support we did get in that area. So even in one of the most wokest places in Brisbane, there was at least 75%. One of the women was taking down, you know, the sort of responses that we got, and the figures that she had was about 70 to 75% of people were supporting us being there.
That's good. It doesn't surprise me.
Mostly positive responses were from men, which surprised me.
Oh.
Yeah. The women were far more negative.
Yeah, or just didn't care.
And we had one man, he sort of stopped for a little while, just asked the question, he walked off. A little while later he came back and he said, "Can I have one of your leaflets?" He said, "I'm really angry about this."
Yeah.
So he took it, and yeah, so I just found the men were more sort of angry about what was going on.
And the men were more willing to take the leaflets than the women were.
Yeah.
The women didn't want to be seen with them.
Yeah. Women generally are more subject to social pressure. Can we say that? Yeah.
It's true. I mean, you can't get away from the difference in the sexes psychologically. It's so true. You can see it.
Yeah. So it was quite a successful action.
It was.
I'm very glad. And the coppers turned up?
Yeah, Three police vans turned up, but
For five women.
Yeah,
two signs standing on a corner. Yeah,
yeah. They went to the pub, so we think the pub maybe phoned the police. But we were already leaving at that time anyway, so we thought we'd quickly jump across to the right outside to the actual plastic surgery and get a few photos outside there, just in case they told us to leave.
Mm. Mm.
So we did that, and then we left.
Yeah.
Oh. And then you put the messages up on social media and they get, you know, circulation.
Yeah.
So, you know, this is all important for us to just activate at a local level.
Yes.
Just do something like this and press the buttons, because we need resistance. We need public resistance on this. And, you know, we're being shut down everywhere.
And if people want to join... the Woman Up Twitter DMs are open. We have a secret action group. You will be obviously vetted, but we have a secret group where we organise these kind of things.
Yeah. We also did an action in May outside of Shannon Fentiman's electoral office.
Yeah.
And we even then we were surprised by the amount of support. It was peaking. Awesome. We just looked there. There were five of us then standing there with just these signs. And the amount of support we got from the passing public was
99% positive.
Yeah. Yeah. We heard one voice in the distance, a male voice singing out, "Go home." And we're going, where's that voice coming from? So, but you know, this is all the politicians. They won't connect with the public because they know the public overwhelmingly does not support this. Yeah. You know, we do these street actions. And we find out the vast majority of the public are completely opposed to it. And they're not opposed to people identifying as whatever they want to.
No.
It's about what's happening to the children and the loss of women's rights. And you know, and gay men are also affected in this as well. So, so any street action we've done has been very, very positive.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's great. Now, on the weekend, you're out and about again?
Yeah.
Series of troublemakers?
Yeah. We had our speakers' corner.
Yeah, so what normally happens with your speakers' corners? How do you normally sort of run those, and what normally happens? And
They usually go off very smoothly. We never really get any pushback apart from the last one we did. We did get some threats of them turning up. And they had even created a group, you know, go and protest the Nazi fascists kind of thing.
That was when the skinheads turned up, was that the
That's
one?
That's when the skinheads turned
up. But are they the skinheads against racism? Is that look like Nazis, but we're not Nazis?
Yeah.
I called the weird old people and they came to my Facebook and started accusing me.
Now, just for the record, ladies, are you far right Nazis?
No.
So far.
Who are you?
No way.
You would have had to take a fairly right turn from the Animal Justice Party.
But you've got, stranger things have happened. Look at Mark Latham.
Although Hitler was a vegetarian, we hate to mention.
Yeah, I've heard that. But I'm worse, I'm vegan, so.
Yes,
But Leah's vegetarian as well.
Yeah.
Oh, right.
So, I'm the odd one out on the carnivore.
They usually go off very well. We're gathering a few more people coming each time, very slowly growing, but it's just about being consistent. But
this week we had another visitor, yeah?
This time. This time we hadn't even started. We were just standing around chatting. Nothing was set up. It was before we were meant to start. We all just wait for everyone to turn up. Sometimes we start a bit late. And so it's probably around 10 minutes to start. So you'd gone to park your car.
Yeah.
So nothing was set up yet. And then I'm just standing there chatting to a lady. I think there's about three or four of us standing around. And I just hear this voice from about maybe 20 meters away saying my name, Leah, shouting, a man's voice. And I look around and he sees me, look at him, and he calls me a stupid woman. Leah, you're a stupid woman. And I think, I know who that is. He's a prolific trans rights activist from Brisbane. I knew who he was. So he was wearing the same outfit that he always wears. He had that bad wig on as well. And then I didn't actually think that he was going to come over to me, but he did. He started marching towards me, and I'm thinking to myself, oh, bloody hell. I didn't, because I hadn't said anything to him at this point. And he comes over to me, and he doesn't stop until he's literally centimetres away from my face. And he's, well, my husband's about 6'4". He's probably got to be about 6'2", something like that. He's big. And he's quite stocky as well. He's a big man. And I wasn't sure what he was going to do. And everybody was in kind of shock because he was still shouting at me as he was walking over. And then he wants me to think that he's going to go for me. So he raises both of his arms like that and he's shouting at me. And it's the most deranged, nonsensical thing. It's actually one of the most weirdest, bizarre things that's ever happened to me, because he was shouting about Twitter. Like, I've never met this man in real life. He only knows what I looked like from my profile picture on Twitter. Whereas you wouldn't know who he was from his profile picture on Twitter, because it's completely different. Like, this is a man. And he's just yelling in my face, screaming at me, with his arms up in the air. The person who's standing next to me actually thinks that he is going to go for me, and they have to separate him away. And then he kind of walks off to the rest, to about three or four people that he's with. I think one of them was his boyfriend. And then as he walks away, his boyfriend's doing the love heart sign to me like that. It's really sinister. And I'm pregnant as well, visibly pregnant now. I'm in my second trimester, so I'm getting there. And I can feel my heart going like this, and my adrenaline's in the sky. And I just am in shock. I'm very shocked about the whole thing that happened. Everyone around is like, what the hell just happened there? And then they're gone. And I think, okay, try and get my stress levels back down again, because you know, when you're pregnant, you're constantly thinking about the baby, constantly thinking about how you're affecting the baby. And so he's gone, and then we have our speaker's corner, and then I see that he's tweeted about it, bragging about how confused and disoriented I looked, which obviously I did, because I've got a man screaming in my face and I didn't know what he was going to do. Behind me was a bench and a fence, so I was kind of blocked in. I didn't really have anywhere to go, and I didn't know what he was going to do. And then when I saw that message, I thought, that is really creepy. I thought, he's bragging about what he's just done, and he's proud of it, and he's named me as well. He's actually named me and said it was lovely to do that. And he's actually deleted that tweet now. So yeah, the whole thing was really bizarre and just completely deranged.
And this is outside, the speaker's corner is outside Parliament House, yeah?
Outside Parliament House, yeah.
And it's near QT.
Yeah.
He may or may not work at QT, is that right?
May or may not, yeah.
Yeah, so QUT is the university, it's right, it's the Garden Points campus, that's right. We've got the Botanical Gardens, QUT, and then it's Parliament House, all in one. And Speaker's Corner's right in the centre of that. So this is out in the public. this in isn't a public square. I mean,
I'm thinking to myself after it happened, I'm thinking, he feels so emboldened and confident of just going up and doing that in the middle of the day to a woman.
And those self-ID laws have come in Brisbane, and I think they have made the trans activists more emboldened. I think we've been seeing that everywhere because they know the law is on their side, and now he's back on Twitter. Is that right, Sue?
The proclamation date has yet to be advised. I did see that months ago that they were looking at 2024. So the bill's been passed. It's been signed off royal assent, but there's no proclamation date. So it isn't the law at the moment.
Mm.
So I guess anything they do, they'll just go, oh, well, it's coming in anyway, so big deal. Mm. But, yeah. Mm. So can you imagine if Leah was in the women's toilets and he spotted her in there? Like the government says, there's nothing to fear.
Mm-hmm.
There is something to fear. If he would do that to Leah in front of people in a public place, what would he have done to Leah if he was alone with her?
Yeah, and this isn't just specific to him. I've noticed this in a lot of the men who are pretending to be women, this aggressive, violent behaviour if you don't go along with what they're with their delusions. And I've never had a man in my face like that before, and I'm 34, so I consider myself actually now looking back very lucky that I've made it this far without having that feeling. Now I know what that feels like. I'm thinking to myself, what about the next woman that doesn't know what's going on in the law, sees him in, or someone like him in their toilet, says, what are you doing here, and gets that? Like, they're capable of doing it at the drop of a hat. If they feel like they could do it in the middle, yeah.
So they have male pattern violence.
Yeah.
And our government, and I've asked Shannon Fentiman, and I can ask the new Attorney General as well, Yvette Darth, you give us proof of how this declaration abates male pattern violence, because we can't see it with our eyes. We see a man intimidating a pregnant woman to the point where someone has to step in a public place in front of our parliament, so full bold out there, and then gets on Twitter and boasts about it, and then gets on Twitter. So you had an interaction with him where he boasted that he had protected characteristics.
Right. He said, you need to remember that as part of the LGBTIQA community in Queensland, it's illegal to discriminate against us or me. And I'm thinking, you just basically assaulted Leah, and you're throwing this at me because I have mentioned it on Twitter, and there's been something like close to 200,000 views about what's happened, and there's been a lot of responses. And he turns around after what he's done and threatens us with the law that basically he's protected.
Well, and he's also since said that I assaulted him, or he was assaulted in some way.
Yeah,
he turned it around, and it's just crazy.
Well, misgendering is assault, right?
He said that if what he did is considered assault, then all the expletives and slurs that were thrown at him, which there were none, then he's been assaulted.
Yeah, he's a man. That's what they don't want.
Now he's pretending he's the victim. And then he said he saw the signs. The signs weren't up because I came back about 10 minutes later and Leah said, he's been here. And then Leah said to me, I'm really worried about the baby because of the stress levels. And it was at that time the signs went up. But he's saying he was casually walking along, saw the signs. The signs weren't up.
But even then, having a sign up is not assault. Mm-hmm. Actually going up to someone and screaming threateningly in their face is assault.
Yep. Well, yep. We applied for the Speaker's Corner. I had written out the paperwork to hold a public, peaceful assembly. And that's how you go about it. I had the paperwork in my bum bag. So we were there legally.
Yeah.
He can have a disagreement with me. That's fine. I even don't mind him shouting at me from a distance. Oh. If he wants to do that, I'm a big girl and I can actually deal with that. So I don't expect everybody to deal with that, but but it was the way he marched over, and I couldn't believe that he just wouldn't stop until he was literally, I could smell him. He was literally in my face.
And that's really it. It is about the intimidation, and it's also about, you know, the intimidation of going back to Twitter and, you know, having this retcon narrative. We see this quite a lot. So the TRAs have their own version of what happened, and they just stick to it like glue, even when it's really not evidenced by any kind of, you know, anything we would normally think of as being like evidence, you know, even when it doesn't actually relate to reality. I'm just wondering, you know, so it is quite a worrying pattern, and we know that this is someone who has, you know, he stretches the truth, and we have evidence of
I think the word I used was hysterical.
He's testerical for certain. He's come over and verbally abused you, and then he's gone over to Twitter and then also, you know, made fun of you and called you, you know, crazy and confused to try to retcon the narrative and to try to make you seem like an aggressor. This is
in his Twitter post that it was lovely to see Leah Whiston today looking confused.
What a horrible thing to say.
It's absolutely.
So I'm just wondering, like, are you sort of concerned about this escalation that we can see? And have you taken any steps on your side to try to document what's going on? And
I'm documenting it. I've taken some steps. I know there's a CCTV camera right in that space. It's one of our girls has actually been on, she looked on Google Earth and she saw that there was a camera right in that area. So I've requested the CCTV footage from that. I'm just waiting on finding out what is going to be the next thing to do. But yeah, I'm taking steps and I'm documenting it.
Yeah, because, I mean, often, like, I know that the police won't necessarily do something about if it's, you know, not sort of a verbal abuse. If it is a verbal abuse. And I think that's more to do with their resources rather than like the letter of the law. But
in saying that, though, they had three police cars turn up for 5 minutes standing on a corner.
Yeah.
It's great, isn't it? We had a little protest once outside the APC, and the police came after we had packed up, and so they chased us down the street. It was quite funny.
You weren't using chalk, were you?
Oh, I cannot say. I cannot recall what we were doing.
With the chalk and haberdashery, these neo-Nazis with their chalk and haberdashery.
With our naughty ribbons. But often, you know, if somebody is showing that pattern of escalation and, you know, it is something that they're doing on a regular basis and on an increasing basis, then that the police do take that much more seriously.
Yeah.
And
one wonders what would happen if Leah's husband had been there. I mean, I know my husband, when I was pregnant, even now, he wouldn't tolerate, and I wouldn't tolerate anyone abusing him either. You know, you defend each other naturally, but it's a different dynamic when you come to men. Because if I'm sticking up like that woman came in and stuck up for you, wanted to give some space. But when men are involved, it's a whole different thing. Violence can escalate very quickly.
There was a man standing in our group when he came over, and he was determined to come over to me. I think the only thing that would have stopped him is maybe if I'd had a camera in my hand.
Yeah.
He might not have done it then. But maybe. He was determined to stomp his way over to me. He was raging.
Mm.
It was just one of the most bizarre situations I've actually ever been in.
Well, I'm sorry that you went through it, Leah, because you've been and the reason he's targeted you is that you have been a consistent warrior in Brisbane, and that you're not in it for any other reason except to stick up for women and girls. You know, you've been very clear about that. And when we do have little babies, I think it does change us. You mentioned that you hadn't been in activism before until this issue, and something about it has caught your fury, hasn't it?
Yeah, I can't just sit back and accept him in my baby's space. I can't. And I don't particularly want to be doing activism. I mean, I don't particularly enjoy speaking in public, but I feel like it's something that I can do, and it's my little part to play in stopping this madness. I would rather be doing other things on a Sunday, you know?
I think a lot of us feel that way.
Yeah.
Like, you know, I'm sure, Sue, you'd rather be out there doing animal rights activism.
Oh, well, I got shunned by the animal rights movement.
Yeah.
We wouldn't have you. And this is one of the things that when these people do hurl women out of their movements, even Julie Zago with The Age and a few other women, I'm never happy to see women treated like that. But you always think, oh, okay, we'll have them. Thanks. They're just making our movement stronger.
The strange thing was when it did happen, and there was a lot of hate from a lot of animal activists, but I got a lot of messages of support from around Australia from other animal activists that were too afraid to come forward because they witnessed this cancelling. So they can't come out and show that they're supporting you, but you do get the messages of support. And even just a few months ago, I got a message from someone in Victoria, I think it was, or Tasmania, saying they just learnt what happened to me and they've resigned as a member of the Animal Justice Party.
Oh, wow.
So, and in Queensland, they had so many resignations of members that they couldn't qualify as a political party. So just recently, a couple of weeks ago, they gave away free membership to keep the party going in Queensland. So,
because they're funded from up, right? So they get, if you, with the animal rights and that sort of thing, you can get grants and you can get funding from other people. So as soon as you
it's different with animal rights. It's very hard.
Is it?
Yeah, because
you get political funding for the votes, though, too. You'd get funding.
You have to get a certain amount of the votes to. It's got to be 4% of the votes if you get money from that.
Yeah.
But anyway, they gave away 240 free memberships and they're still afloat in Queensland. But that reeks of desperation. And they should take note that animal activists don't want it to be a trans party. They want it to be a party that represents the animals. But that's all due to one man in Victoria with his two trans-identifying children. And, you know, that's exploitation of animals. But anyway, so they learned hopefully they've learned a lesson from it, but.
They sort of cut off their nose despite their faces, don't they? Like, there's no way, I can't really see how you can justify or how you can, marry up the arguments for animal justice with the animal, with the arguments for trans medicine.
Yeah, that's right. Like,
it's high tech medicine versus nature and doing things, that benefit animals. Yeah,
the research with the uteruses. They have been experimenting on rats. And with the rats, they found that the male rat wasn't surviving with a uterus. So what they did was attach the female to the male rat.
My God.
So all this sort of research is going on, and you've got the animal justice party supporting an ideology. You know, they're against big pharma. They talk about nature, you know, the environment, how unnatural to do this to human beings. So everything they stand for, it's hypocritical. Doesn't make sense.
No, the experimental, I mean, basically this is an experimental. There's no science behind transing children either. I mean, there is, but it's not in their favour.
Yeah.
So this is basically a live experiment on children as well. So anyone who cares about the animals of humans, which we all do, you know, it's unethical. I don't know if they would have even, you know, done a lot of this to animals. Certainly not animals that we like. You know, rats, most of us will forgive because they've got a terrible reputation, haven't they?
That's because of their tail.
Yeah, but rats are so social. Like when you actually have rats in a lab, you've got to like get them out and you've got to pat them and be their friend, and otherwise they can't cope with being isolated. And it's part of what the scientists do is they have to actually get them out and pat them and everything.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, so for the animals,
it's very sad.
Our party to support that sort of experimentation.
Yeah.
Doesn't make sense, and that's why they're having to give away memberships.
Yeah, well, the whole you know, civil rights movements have been co-opted now, haven't they? Corrupted, except for grassroots, which is what we're trying to build.
Yep.
And we're listening to what their narratives are, and we're finding out what they don't want us to do. And one of the things they don't want us to do is to expose what they're doing, particularly to children, because it's very unpopular. And so they say in their own documents, you know, we need to put pressure on the media to not speak about this stuff. So we know, and we can see through recently The Age, we know that organisations are having pressure not to talk about this stuff. So we have no choice but to expose it.
Yeah. And just recently with Gillian Spencer, she's been very brave coming out.
Yes.
Psychiatrist of the Children's Hospital. So her speaking out hopefully will make others speak out.
That's right, yeah. And we looked at Dr. Stathis's ideology a few weeks ago, and, you know, we want to give these people the benefit of the doubt, but there's no basis to it. There's no logic. There's no anything. It's all unethical practice. And the thing that the trans activist bloke, he needs to make someone like Leah has been very outspoken on Brisbane issues on the internet, on Twitter. He needs to make you the enemy. He's already made you the enemy, and he needs to make you deranged. That's what he's trying to do, and that's what men have always done to women.
Yep.
Who have spoken up. They've said that they're hysterical. Ironically, he says that that they're imbalanced. And that's why he says, oh, she looked deranged. She looked, you know,
disoriented. I was confused. He's right. I was confused. I didn't know what he was going to do.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, I can be mouthy, but when you're faced with a man, and I'm 5'8", so I'm not tiny, but when you're faced with a man who's towering over you, screaming at you in public, and it does make you, it just confuses you. I've never had that before.
Yeah. I think when you're pregnant too, all your instincts are heightened.
Yeah.
This is one of the natural things that these people will never know, is that when your body changes in that way, you get the sensation, I don't know if you ladies felt it, but I thought you feel like there's something alien happening to you. All of a sudden, you know, I mean, I started crocheting and, you know, yeah. Something else happens is taking, and you start to get frightened in situations you weren't frightened before. Yeah. You think that you're bulletproof. Yeah. All of a sudden, when you start growing a human in you, it's not from here. There's something that happens in your biology where you become hyper aware, and you know that protecting that thing, whatever it is inside you, your body is on hyper alert.
Yeah. And that happens across all species as well.
Yeah, it would be.
All species that produce.
Yeah, we forget that we're mammals. We are mere mammals.
Mm.
That's right. And that's what we're reminded. Women are reminded of that more than men.
Exactly. there's something different about humans that I can't put my finger on, and we all know there's something different about humans that makes us human, but we are mammals.
That's right. Well, we have a big brain.
Yeah.
And this guy's mother has bigger hips because he is a big-brained animal. And he is a big-brained animal. That's why women are slower. That's why women are more, you know, prone to certain occupations. We have a different biology. And so he's disrespecting the hips that bore him. The reason we have bigger hips is because we all have such massive brains, and we take, you know, 18 years to mature. No other animal. Is there any other animal that takes that long to mature? I don't know. But we have a massively long childhood, which is, you know, it takes us ages to mature, which is why it's such a bloody travesty that they're interjecting themselves in these children's lives and teaching them this horror that makes them take their breasts off. It's just
disgraceful.
And we are the ones that don't that care so deeply about these children and the women that are involved in this, and we're made out to be Nazis. It blows my mind, but I don't really care about that slur anymore because it's I know it's not true. But just the lengths that they will go to silence us when we care, we love these children.
It does
stand outside with signs to prove that.
The Nazi slur does bother me, only because I find it very disrespectful.
Yeah.
You know, do they know about the Holocaust? Do they understand what a Nazi actually is? And then they say it's a genocide. It's so disrespectful.
Yeah, I can understand it is disrespectful, and I completely respect your right to feel offended.
Oh, but I know where you're coming from, though.
I just know that it's not true. So it doesn't go in.
Yeah.
I think, Leah, too, you're a resilient person. You're a fairly tough sort of person. I mean, you've obviously travelled, you know, to the other side of the world to set up a life. And sometimes it takes us, when we, as women, we, like with men, they get less vulnerable as they get older, when they more vulnerable as they get weaker. Women learn their vulnerability, I think, when they have children. It's a very quick lesson. And so I think some of that is you're just getting caught off guard because you're out there being a warrior, doing everything you need to do, and all of a sudden you've got male pattern violence, you know, in your face. It's not fair. It's not right. It shouldn't be happening is my take on this.
And yeah, and it was a brand new experience for me that I obviously hadn't had that wiring in my brain to have that experience of a man doing that. So it's completely new, but it's given me a massive insight into what some women have to deal with from men. And I've been saying, you know, women having to deal with male violence in our spaces, it's awful. But now I actually know what it feels like. It's just made me even more determined to keep cracking on.
Yeah. Good on you. Because these men are often misogynist, you know. They wear their clothes and stuff, but this is misogyny writ large. It's massive misogyny.
It's definitely deeply embedded, this hate towards women.
Yeah.
And I don't think the amount of estrogen that they're taking, I think that is really a big factor in this as well.
Ah.
Because men with higher estrogen, excess estrogen, and lower, which causes them to have lower testosterone, it causes anxiety, depression. I mean, this man who did this, you can tell he is riddled with anxiety, I would say. Not a confident person. They never are, men that treat women like this. They're never confident. And the amount of estrogen that they're taking is affecting their behaviour.
It's interesting, isn't it? Because I think, is it Elaine? She talks about, I can't remember her last name, she's a Scottish woman, who the Merkin lady.
Yeah.
She talks about the effect of estrogen on women versus men. and that women, I mean, I'm recently started HRT to replace, you know, the estrogen that falls off. And she talks about that female organs are estrogen thirsty. So that's why when women go cross-sex hormones, they often have hysterectomies as well, because they experience their organs need the estrogen to be there. But the interesting thing, I've never read much about the effect of estrogen on males.
Actually causes a syndrome called irritable male syndrome. It's interesting to read. And there's definitely something to it.
Yeah, well, the irritable male.
And imagine the way that he was talking and shouting at me about Twitter was the main topic that he was shouting at me about. And after, I thought, that's really interesting, because he obviously lives his life online. His profile picture looks nothing like him in real life. You wouldn't know it was the same person. So going out into the real world and looking as he does must be actually really anxiety inducing for him, because he's a man. He's a big man.
Yeah. He always
go on.
Yep. He always publishes these pictures of him looking, you know, really sort of cute and sassy. And but they're always, it's that trick where you hold the camera up and you sort of look up with your eyes, and it makes your chin look really pointy. Yeah. And
it's hard. They can control everything online about who they are. This trans movement would be nothing without the internet and filters. It just wouldn't have taken off. This was the sweet spot for it, because of the filters and the online personas and everything. It's actually fascinating when you think about how it's caught on. Depressingly fascinating.
It's that perfect storm, isn't it? Yeah. Like there's just the right amount of technology coming in at the right time. And but even the kids who are sort of coming of age, even the kids who are sort of coming up today, they filters are already old and already boring, and you know, all of this stuff that's really captivated you know, the people who are 13 and up. The kids who are just a bit younger than that, they sort of like, oh, you know, they it's not new for them.
No.
And they already are wise to it, and they're not taken in by that.
Yeah.
So it's this perfect storm. It's all just happened at the right time.
Yeah.
Mm. Well, he's often retweeted as well, but he appears to be reasonably well connected in some ways. We've seen him speak a word and seen things happen in the ABC. So we know he's got some connections there. We know he's got some sympathy online. Sometimes I don't know if he's been retweeted by what's his name, the red scarf guy, Fitzsimons. But that sort of group of people are very sympathetic to this kind of person and this kind of trans personality on Twitter, where they constantly talk about their own vulnerability, because that vulnerability is very useful, for these guys, for the elites to kind of weaponize it against us. So they love to be in that world where they're the stars. But then they walk into, you know, reality, and he's obviously spotted you. He said he saw the signs, but he's obviously spotted you, because he's yelled out your name from afar and thought, right, I'm going to bring Twitter to real life here.
Yes.
In Gardens Point.
Exactly.
And it doesn't look, you know, you try and we've seen those sketches. Remember those sketches where they would say people bringing Twitter, saying things in real life that you say on Twitter? It seems ridiculous. So he's obviously decided to go to pretend like you're the profile and give his aggression. Yeah. But in real life, it's another
thing. I've got a lovely, gorgeous husband, a beautiful daughter, another one coming on the way. I'm living in the real world, and I feel like there is a lot of depression among these men. Be online that often and live your life online as your online persona must be just just an awful way to live.
Yeah.
Well, luckily that is not us, and luckily we I think it's really terrible that you've been abused in this way, but like it does show that what you're doing is effective. It's hitting home, and they don't like it. They don't like that you're speaking. They don't like that you're living in the real world and that you're not chronically online, and they don't like that they can't just cancel you with the press of a button. And so
And thanks for being out there
keep
too,
doing it,
Leah. Yeah. We appreciate your work, both of you. You're great warriors, and we want to try and highlight some of the work that women are doing on the streets, you know, at their local MP's office. Sue is a great connector with all the different people. She knows everybody. She knows when the bills are going through, and
Sue is awesome.
She's great. Yeah. These are the women that are the basis of this movement. You know, we don't need superstars. We just need a range of women who are just able to put the boots on the ground. And hopefully we can highlight them more often.
Yeah, it's a big task, isn't it? But we're in there for the long haul.
It's a massive task, but it's a grassroots. We have to make, I'm convinced of this. You know, I spent a couple of years trying to figure out what the best way forward was, but I'm convinced that it's only grassroots resistance. Yeah. It's exposing what they're doing, you know, just being diligent, writing them stupid letters because they're such idiots, these politicians.
But it's also politicians, the thing they fear the most is not being voted back in.
Yes.
So the more we can get out to the public and educate them, and once politicians realise there's no votes in pushing this ideology, then they'll quickly turn.
The other thing is to make it impossible to implement. You know, we want the plastic surgeons to say, look, we're not going to offer this because of ethical reasons. We want the Board of Plastic Surgeons to say, to step in and say, okay, we want to expose them as well, because they're private companies, profit-making companies, and the role of the government has always been to step in and ensure that they've got an ethical standard that is not driven by the market. Once you have the market driving ethics of plastic surgery, you know, there's a world of harm, particularly to do with children. So we want to try and pressure the Board of Plastic Surgeons. We want to try and pressure all those people to stop and think, okay, are we going to have these women outside our clinic or are we going to not offer this surgery? Mm. So back to the public system. Another highlight quickly is that this is a private system that they're paying for. When they went to the gender clinic, that'd be public. So the gender clinic of the Queensland Hospital, the Children's Hospital, the guy that did the referral quickly, he would be public funded, so that wouldn't have cost them anything. Then in Queensland, you have the option of surgery, but our waiting list is so high for elective surgery, even if it was covered under Medicare, the waiting list, the kid would be safe by the time, that would be sort of a stopgap measure. The kid would be safe. You'd have 2 years on the waiting list, and by that stage, the kid would go, you know what, this is not such a good idea. So they're bypassing the public with the private sector. So we do need to attack. By attack, I mean with words and with signs.
Yeah, I'm
just make that clear.
Yeah.
the private sector.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
You did a good thing, Leah, by what you did. So hopefully you've saved a few lives and maybe make that plastic surgery think about the ethics and in what they're doing.
Well, it's one drop in the bucket. I look at it like, you know,
it starts with one.
It's a big bucket that we've got to fill up.
Yeah.
Well, I knew a pastor who used to say, we can't solve the oceans of the world's problems, but we can only just take our little bucket.
Yeah.
So I always thought that was a reasonably appropriate analogy, because we do get overwhelmed by the size of the problem.
And this is there are multiple things going on. So we can, one person can't do it all. We need to work together with others, and we need, you know, we need a lot of strong women leading in their particular little area and working side by side and networking and sharing. And, you know, we need to be able to rely on each other. And it is really good to see groups like Woman Up forming and embodying that spirit, of working together in collaboration.
Yeah, we're a fairly new group too. So we've only been, we only formed it a couple of months ago.
It's going really well though.
Already having a really good impact. Yeah. It's great to see. Yeah.
And there's a few groups, and they're not, it's not like a market where they're in competition. Some groups do Speaker's Corner, other and submissions, and other groups do other things. So I've enjoyed watching the way that groups are kind of forming in my city and other cities, because it's going to take a lot of them.
Yeah.
We need everyone.
Yeah.
And it's growing.
Mm.
You can see it in the last 12 months, it's quite noticeable.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah, so it's onwards and upwards.
Yeah.
But the sad thing is, though, once it's done and dusted, and I really believe it will be, we can get on with our lives where these kids that are being mutilated, that's a lifetime affliction that they'll have to deal with. So if we can save one, it's worth it.
Yeah, that's right. And also give the message to the parents that we're on their side. We get messages from parents. And I always tell them, look, I'm not a specialist in this area. I can almost offer you almost no help, personally, individually. But together we can think about strategies and work towards helping these parents and let them know they're not alone.
Yeah,
that we're not all insane.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you so much for joining us, ladies. It's been really wonderful to have you on and to hear about what you're doing, and we hope to get you back on to talk about your next big success.
Thank you for having us.
Yeah, thank you.
Thanks, ladies. See you in the streets.
Yeah.